stand up and sing this next one together. What can wash our sins away? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Your blood speaks a better word than all the empty claims I heard upon this earth. Speaks righteousness for me.
Thank you.
got together. Leaders, amen. The Mitchells and the Morelleses in Prescott, Arizona. Let's remember the hearts, the Galvans and the Cassios and all those who labor in our fellowship, all the churches throughout the world. Let's pray also for the East Coast, the Campos and the Guineers and the upcoming conference in April. Amen. Let's believe, God, that they will launch some more churches. Amen. That some disciples will be ready with their wives to go out into the unknown and preach the everlasting gospel and do a work for Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's believe, God, together for the Suspanskys and the Kings laboring in Jacksonville. And let's also believe, God, for my pastor, Pastor Keith and Carrie Sullivan, and the East Rochester Church and their endeavors with their new building. Let's pray that God helps all their new converts to make good choices, bless their families, and heal the sick. Do miracles tonight, even tonight. Bring in backsliders and do wonderful manifestations of God's love to help people. Amen. We're going to pray for also some local needs here. We're going to pray for Unsuk and Suki and Joshua Coe. Amen. Let's also pray for, amen, our policemen, our firefighters, active military, that God would overshadow their lives. Amen. Let's pray also for the Englerth family, Shanti and Vanessa, Mark's daughter. Let's also believe, God, for Flora and her twins. Amen. And her situation. Then let's pray for Barry. Let's pray for Annie Benedict and all that God can accomplish in their lives. Perhaps you have a need in your life that I did not mention. I'm going to ask you to lift your hand. You're asking God to help you in some significant way that is something that can't be resolved with wisdom or human ingenuity, but it's going to be a miracle, and you need God to help you, and I'm there right along with you. Amen. God, help us in all our endeavors, our finances, making us fruitful in 2022. Amen. To find the will of God for our lives, amen, is a precious thing. Let's pray for the upcoming Saturday night movie. We're going to have visitors here in the church building. Let's pray for that to be fruitful, souls to be converted. Amen. We're going to pray for the impact teams that are up and coming into Pittsburgh and into Connecticut. Amen. And let's also pray for our 180 scene March 26th. That's going to be right here in our building. We're going to play some music. There'll be some bands playing and some rap and some different artists. Amen. Let's back that with the Holy Spirit. Let's believe, amen, God, for great fruitfulness in this time. Amen. Let's go ahead and pray together. And David Bergsman, can you please open us up in prayer when we subside? Let's pray, church. Father in heaven, there's none like you. You're able to save and quicken and raise the dead and heal the sick. And we contend right now against every principality and ruler of wickedness. We command you to loose your grip on people here in Greece, New York. Give us souls converted. Make Rochester a net for the nations, God. And cause people to be captivated by the Holy Ghost, God. Let them be convicted by their sin, Lord God. Backsliders to see how important it is to have a godly fear, a reverence of you, God. And to be brought back into your care and be brought back into your covering, your grace and your wonder, God. Help all the first responders, Lord God, all those who labor. Help all our churches, God. Move upon the new churches that have been just planted out of the January conference, Lord God. Let them have success. Let there be miracles. Let Jesus be lifted up in our
You are encounter with you have been transformed. We can talk to you and you can talk. talk to them. We know that nothing else will work in this time. We know that as the nations fall down into the cesspool of sin, that you are the only answer. And only a direct connection with you will help. Not the time for religion, it's time for relationship, Lord. And we ask that you give us the grace to turn to you and have that close relationship so that you can fill us with your wisdom, fill us with your power, show us what you're doing. Give us the anointing to actually touch people, Lord, so that they can be transformed, born again, and made new. In your name, Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Let's take a minute to greet one another. Make everybody feel welcome tonight. See everybody in church. Amen. We're thankful that the pillars are here. Amen. And if you're listening online, we want to welcome you to Greece Potter's House. Hallelujah. Where Jesus Christ has given us miracles and there's healings. And God's saving us. And we're so thankful that you're here joining us. Amen. A few announcements for the local church. This Sunday at 10 o'clock, we will be back in our adult Sunday school. And at 10:30, we have our morning worship. The Sunday evening service starts at 5:30. That's prayer time. Amen. That's when church starts. Amen. And God will help you, amen, to understand more what's going on as you get into the prayer room. And more anointing will come on your life. You're going to have answer to prayer. Amen. When you get into the prayer room and you get a hold of God. 6:30 is our evening service. Amen. Wednesday nights, we're always going to be here at 6:30. For our midweek service, and 7:30 is when the show begins. Hallelujah. This Saturday we'll be on outreach at 11 o'clock, and we're going to go into the neighborhoods and invite people to. Our event for Saturday night is the movie night. Amen. And thank God that we can invite people to church, a different kind of a venue. Do you have that little clip there? It should be really available. And, you know, we can invite people to church and with a different kind of an angle. Some people like movies, and I don't think they've ever seen this one. So you invite your best friend. You invite somebody that's in your life, amen, that I do not know. And I'm going to invite 100 people on Saturday in the outreach and some other people throughout the week when I have an opportunity. You can do that in the restaurants, in the the grocery store, whenever you get a chance, amen. And take a few flyers in the back and evangelize, because Jesus Christ is coming back.
Amen.
Amen. He's coming back. He's looking for people that are serious about him. Amen. He's not looking for a dead church. He's looking for a live church, a live wire. Amen. And that's why we're excited about what God is doing. Amen. Some of these announcements you're already familiar with. The April Bible Conference in Cape Cod is the 11th through the 15th of April. Amen. We are also going to be traveling out of town in March on the 19th, which is a Saturday. We're going to leave at 7 o'clock. We're going to be sending an impact team to Pastor Javier in Manchester, Connecticut. Amen. We also have a 180 scene that's going to be a rock scene here. The kids are going to rap. We're going to minister the gospel of Jesus Christ, and there are going to be some testimonies here. Maybe you can give your testimony, and we're going to try to make an impact here, reaching the lost. I'm not talking about religious people. I'm talking about people that are just plain old, flat out, completely insane in sin, know nothing about God. Those are the people you want to bring here to get them saved. Amen. We'll take a few religious people. If you find people that talk some kind of lingo, or if you know a backslider, amen, invite them. We would love them. We would love to have them come and hear that music that night. We're also going to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania on the 30th of April. Amen. We're sending an impact team there. And come get a hold of what God has for your life. Amen. He can use your life to get other people saved, and that's an exciting thing. Amen. Did I make all the announcements properly? Did I miss anything?
I don't know.
We're good.
It's fine.
Yeah, we'll give you the details for next month on this Sunday. Bible study, we'll do another movie, and then we'll probably have another unique outreach. Let's take up our offering. And this is called David's Offering from 2 Samuel 6. Verses 16 through 19. Now, as the ark of the Lord came into the city of David, David was dancing before the Lord. He offered burnt offerings and peace offerings before the Lord. And when David finished offering the burnt offerings and peace offerings, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord of hosts. Then he distributed among the people, among the whole multitude of Israel, both women and men, to every one of them a loaf of bread and a piece of meat and cakes of raisins. He was a very generous man and a very generous king. And he realized that without God, he could not be a righteous king. So he brought the ark, amen, into the city of David, amen, where he was living. And God gives us an opportunity, even tonight, to give. I ask the usher to come forward. Let's give an offering tonight. Amen. A sacrificial offering, an offering that invites God into this service and into your life, an offering that gets his attention, not just a joke or some coins you found in the Davenport or in the back of your car, right? But something that you plan to give and something that's sacrificial. Amen. God loves a cheerful giver. Let's give out of just a happiness to be saved. Brother David, can you pray with the offering?
Yeah, we thank you, Lord. Again, we're reminding ourselves of how well you take care of us.
Yep.
It's really unbelievable how well you take care of us. And we thank you for the opportunity to give back to you. We thank you knowing that we can trust you to do good things with what we give. Not that you need the money, but you need people who are willing. Whatever you ask for.
Amen. Thank you for praying. And thank you for your giving tonight. We greatly appreciate it. And God's building his church. Amen. Let's sing one of these songs. Amen.
You live the life that I should have lived. And you died the death that I should have died. So you could forgive. God, in my place was
God. Turn with me in your Bible to the book of Revelation. And one of the last books that we suggest a new convert to read. Because it's full of all these kind of wild creatures and kind of like a Grateful Dead concert where you're tripping on acid, doing drugs. But really, we find here in the book of Revelation illumination of what God is doing. He's showing light on what's about to come. We need to be prepared for the future. You know, in Nairobi, Kenya, there's a 21-story building under construction, and they said that last Monday it crumbled to the ground in Lagos, Nigeria's financial capital and Africa's largest city, leaving what workers said were as many as 100 construction workers trapped, and at least 5 were dead in the latest structural failure in a rapidly expanding metropolis. The collapse occurred about 2 p.m. in the upscale neighborhood of Ekoyai, where construction is booming. In a country where building materials are often poor quality and construction standards are poorly enforced, according to experts. 4 people have so far been rescued from the site, according to the Ibrahim Ferlone, the coordinator of the National Emergency Management Agency in Lagos State. Many more people were feared to be trapped inside the rubble. 2 workers in the scene told Reuters that 100 people were likely to be working on the site when the building gave way. And that building's integrity is found in the construction. Doesn't have the ability to stand up to the weight of the roof, the walls. Can it stand up to the forces of nature as the wind is blowing on it? And it can't stand the test of time. There's one of the tallest buildings in the world that I'm remembering right now. I studied it. It's in the Middle East. It's the tallest building in the world. But what's interesting about the design is it's completely and radically different than any other building, able to withstand the wind because the way that it is created, it has an ability to take the wind as the wind is coming, and there's certain wind foils that blow, and everything is not all in one on one side. They're kind of staggered around it. Does anybody know which building I'm talking about?
I can't pronounce it, but yeah, it's half a mile high or something like that.
It's the high, yeah, it's just incredible. But the design is able to withstand, you know, the forces of nature. And they talk about building a building on sand. They had to actually put like rock down and many pylons to distribute the weight. And I want to talk about pillars tonight, because without pillars, amen, we are not going to stand up. We are not going to last unless we have pillars. Revelation 3, verse 10. John the Revelator is writing here as he's having a vision of Jesus Christ, who is the Alpha and the Omega. He shows up on the Lord's Day. Amen. This is Sunday. Hallelujah. And Jesus shows up and begins to speak to him. Revelation 3:10. Jesus is speaking to John, because you have kept my command to persevere, I will keep you from the hour of trial which shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. Behold, I am coming quickly. Hold fast to what you have, that no man may take your crown. He who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God. And he shall go out no more. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from my God. And I will write on him my new name. He who has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Amen. God is in great need here in his church for pillars. Our need this evening is to become a pillar in the house of God. Amen. When a person becomes born again, it's very important that quickly they find a local church. Even in the Billy Graham Crusades, he always tries to connect people with local churches as he was traveling throughout the world. Because it's easy to get somebody saved, but to keep them is a different world. And becoming a pillar is what we always suggest. Find a local church, lock into it, and become faithful. Hallelujah. Usually the church they should attend is where they got saved or where they rededicated their life to Jesus. We normally recommend that that's the church that you go to. It is in the best interest of the convert to lock in to what is going on in that local church. It's for their benefit. It's for their healing. It's for all the good things that God has in store for them. Because they're in that local church, knowing those people, having a pastor to help you, it will bring a protection over your life. This is for every convert. Amen. It would be like leaving a baby out in a snowstorm.
Right.
You want that baby to have a home, a protected, want it to be in a warm place. You want it to be fed. Amen. And God will always have a place for that new convert to go to. And secondly, in addition to being protected in a church, amen, what the new convert is supposed to do, and God by God's design, is to become a learner, or in other words, a disciple, someone who is asking questions, somebody who is able to be formed, somebody who can be trained or taught, somebody who has a teachable spirit, where they can begin to learn about living as a Christian. And then thirdly, to grow, we need to understand that that new convert needs to have a place, amen, where they can grow and mature and be brought to a place of fruitfulness in their life. Amen. They, in turn, will become an asset to other people. Amen. They will, because of their faithfulness to that local church, they will be a great help to other people, maybe other new believers, other people who might not have it all together. They will be, amen, able to encourage them and help them in their salvation. Becoming a pillar is the revelation that becoming faithful to a church gathering is needed for individuals' spiritual health and the support of the local church. Amen. I'm going to give you some very good reasons to continue, if you are a pillar in this church, to continue your faithfulness, sister. And if you're not faithful, or you're online and you're listening at a different time, that there is a great respect that we need to have for the church. And there's great fruitfulness that God will add to your life as you find that local church and lock into it. Amen. Thirdly, there's a need to overcome for every Christian. If the Christian believer is going to overcome or become an overcomer, overcoming the devil, overcoming the world, overcoming their flesh, overcoming their weaknesses and inabilities, they're going to need, amen, to find a church where they can lock in and realize that this is the place where they can connect with God, where they can become empowered, where they can get the tools and the weapons that they can fight to become an overcomer. There's no reason to be lonely or depressed. Man, there's no reason. You have people here that love you. You have people in a church that will be able to relate to you, that will encourage you. There's no reason to skip church and leave out and become just enamored with yourself and your own thoughts and your own delusion. and be confused and just empty of relationship. There's no reason for it. And then we have a church here where we can live in relationship with other people that are sold out. Amen. For Jesus. There's so many lukewarm Christians in the world who just, you know, want to show up when they want to show up, whenever feels right. If the Lord leads me. I've heard that a million times. But dutifully, amen, and faithfully, regardless of your feelings, amen, like a military campaign where you have to be there to protect your fellow soldiers. Amen. Out of complete faithfulness and duty, you will become an overcomer. The devil's doing a very good job in our culture of separating people. Mm-hmm. Putting them apart, giving them issues so they fight, or just like you don't want to have any contact with people, COVID-19, you don't want to get sick. Cover your mouth, young man, right? You cough in the mall, somebody is going to correct you. And we need, as Christians, to grow. We need other Christians to help us to overcome our weaknesses. We're much stronger when we're together than when we are apart, when we're separated. God will use the individual to help others. You can help other people overcome their problems. That's the glory of having a church. Your church, your own church. Amen. Other people are going to help you, and you're going to be a blessing to other people when you show up at that church, when you start being faithful to that work. Amen. God will grow us as overcomers to become fruitful and to let God use our lives. Amen. What a glorious thing. Amen. There's plenty of opportunity to minister to others. We can minister, amen, and that means we can talk to people. We can help them in the context of church, in the local church. You don't know how glorious it is. Hebrews 10:25, amen, starting at 23. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering. Wavering is like, you know, somebody who can't make a decision. Wavering is like, you know, you're oscillating between this idea and that. You can't make up your mind which, you know, pair of sneakers to put on. You're wavering back and forth. Or do I wear the red ones, the Converse, or the purple Nikes? You're wavering back and forth. Amen. And God is telling us to stop wavering and start to be more of a solid a decision maker. For he who promises faithful, that's God. Let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works. You can't love other people if you're home hiding in the basement, or if you're off on trips, traveling all around the world. You can't, you know, help other people that are here in your local church. Verse 25, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some. Even in Paul's day, people were skipping church to go to the Buffalo Bills game.
Yeah,
right. Or the Super Bowl, no? Well, we have our priorities, that's fine. As is the manner of some, he says, but exhorting one another, and so much more as you see the day approaching. Today, people are like, they have no ability to be reprimanded or corrected or helped or talked to or encouraged. They melt like a snowflake. Amen. Let's look at three promises that God gives us in this scripture that we can all hold on to. Number one, if you keep his command, he promises that I am going to keep you from the trial. It's a great trial that's coming on the earth. Revelation 3:10, because you have kept my command to persevere, I will also keep you from the hour of trial, which shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. And I believe that this is talking about the rapture here. God wants to include you in the rapture. He doesn't want you to be left behind during the tribulation period. The great tribulation is coming right after the rapture. That is a different age in which people will have no rights. They will have to bow down to a one world leader called the Antichrist. You will be forced to get a mark on your forehead or in your hand that is the number of the beast, 666. If you want to buy things, if you want to sell things, if you want to eat, you're going to have to be part of the culture, part of the society, and you'll have to have that code. There will be unbearable horror, horrid, treacherous events that are going to happen during that time period on the earth, with the Antichrist ruling the entire world, ruling entirely every individual who bears his mark. You can run and you can run, but you cannot hide, because he's going to have GPS. He will find you, and you will either be martyred or you will serve him. And God doesn't want you to be part of that. God doesn't want you to be left behind. He's saying, I will keep you out of that. I want to keep you back from that torturous time, that great trial that's going to come on the earth. God promises, if we continue to persevere, we will be delivered from that day of wrath. Man, we were not designed for wrath. Amen. Secondly, the second promise that you can hold on to is that if you stand fast, if you hold fast, you will not lose your crown. No one will take your crown, it says here. Verse 11, behold, I'm coming quickly, instantaneously. Amen. It's going to be less than a split second for us. He says, hold fast what you have, that no one may take your crown. This leads me to believe that you can lose your crown, and that many will lose their crown because of an inability to hold fast. Like holding on to this. You see some of those videos on YouTube or the TikToks, and there's a windstorm, a hurricane, and people are being blown across the street. They're not holding on to anything. Many people will give up on believing because of persecution or cares in their life. Jesus predicted it when he taught the lesson about the seed that was planted. Some seed falls by the wayside and it's just blown away, or it's eaten up by the birds. Other seed comes up too quickly. There's a shallow ground there. Amen. And it dies just as quickly as it came up. But then there's the third kind of seed, or the third kind of a man's heart, where the seed takes root. Something's growing there. I don't know if there's any fruit in that life, but the thorns of this life, the cares, the riches, the materialism, or the persecution that you go through as a Christian chokes the life out of you, and you do not bear fruit. You do not continue. There are persecution and cares of this life that are going to try to rip you off of your faith. And unless you're careful, amen, it's going to happen to you. And it'll happen to you. It'll happen to anybody who is not holding fast. That's like protecting your relationship with Jesus. Amen. Holding fast. This leads me to believe, amen, that someone can take your crown. Someone can take your crown. You can lose your crown, it says here in this scripture. Many will give up on believing because of persecution or just the cares of this life, the daily struggles that you go through. Some people say, it's not worth it. I'm not going to live as a Christian anymore. And they backslide. They turn their back on God, who saved them, who gave them a great inheritance, and they're walking away from it. They don't believe anymore. And they backslide, and for sure they're going to lose their crown. God promises you and I that we will be rewarded in the end if we remain connected to the church. Something significant about remaining in the church, and all your faithfulness will not be forgotten. This is the promise that you and I have to hold on to, or it's going to slip away from us. And pretty soon we'll be a statistic. Third promise, if you overcome, God makes you a pillar in the temple. Verses 12, it says, he who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go out no more. That means you remain, amen, in the temple. Overcoming means that the Christian who is locked into a specific church has made strong, has been strengthened through various trials, who's been through some horrendous situations, and because of their faith, amen, they've been able to stick it out and stay by this stuff, and have been able to stand through all of that. They have overcome the devil. They've been able to overcome their flesh, and they have begun to discipline themselves to the point that their home is in order, and they've made a habit to come to church. Amen. These are some disciplines that, you know, can be painful and can be hard to really create. Every good habit, it's going to take some time. But once you make it, amen, it'll be a blessing to your life. They realize that God has called them to this church for a specific reason. Amen. And once you get into that church, get involved, amen, and do everything that God has called you to do. And then be faithful to show up when the pastor is preaching. Show up when there's an outreach. Amen. Get involved. And if there's a prayer meeting, get into the prayer meeting and get into the prayer room. And God will help you and richly bless you. What a glorious function that the pillar of the assembly holds. And that means somebody in the house of God who comes to church regularly, who's involved, they're bearing the weight of that building. They're bearing the weight of that church. They have become a pillar. Amen. You guys love to play Jenga, right? It's the same principle. There's certain structure there, and if you pull out the wrong piece, the whole thing crumbles. We could put a name on every one of those pieces in the Jenga game. Your name, your name, your name. And then we take it out, we remove it, and see if the building still stands. Amen. It's glorious to be a part of a church. I've been part of a church for over 35 years. And to be involved in what God is doing. And God has made me able to be faithful and to see that there's nothing that compares to the church of the living God. There's nothing going on tonight. No other place that I'd rather be but right here, amen, in God's presence with you. It is both victorious that God has chosen us to uphold our church, but at the same time, it's a sacred responsibility that we all hold, amen, to be here when God shows up. Amen. We're worshiping God together, and his presence comes down and fills this room. A way to know that the individual is more important than the work. That means you. Because without you, there is no work. There's nothing that's going to stand here. There's nothing worth spending time at without you here in the work. Amen. If you overcome, amen, God will make you a pillar. The pillars are so important to the building's construct. You and I have a privilege and a responsibility to be pillars here in the house of God. A pillar is a part of a building that is in place. It's not moving. It's grounded and strong. Pressures, wind, storms do not keep them from undergirding the structure. Pillars bring stability to every church. They are the members who come faithfully and usually often. Paul is speaking to the church in Corinth here. He says to them, do you not know that you are the temple of God? 1 Corinthians 3:16. Pillars, therefore, are used in an architectural context to describe vertical standing structures, usually made of stone, metal, or wood. Both are physical structures in cylindrical form, standing upright, amen, usually to support much larger structures above them, like different kinds of beams. Yep, a pillar is faithful to hold up the structure. If the pillar falls down, it could still be in the building, but it's no good. It's not helping the church to stand. The church needs pillars that are standing upright, and that is what is going to be helpful to the church. The Bible teaches us that those who are mature in the faith ought to bear the scruples or the weaknesses of those who might be new people. They might be new converts. They might have be going through something and really are just like really, you know, tore up inside. The strong ought to bear the weak. So for some of us, maybe we're not able to carry the weight. We're not able to bear the load. It's just too much for us. That's why, amen, we need to step up. Amen, we need to hold our weight together.